Welcome to a short demo on MJ Platform's cultivation module. In this video, you'll see the powerful MJ Analytics reporting engine included with any MJ Platform subscription. We'll also cover the intuitive workflows that manage your operation and the backend systemic controls to keep your business compliant. If you'd like to see how MJ Platform can meet the needs of your dynamic cannabis business, schedule a demo after the video.
So here, we'll be taking a look at the MJ Platform Cultivation solution in action. We'll first start out with a quick look at the analytics and reporting features of Platform. We'll then transition into a brief look under the tent and some of the settings and setup of the system. And then finally, we'll look at the day-to-day operations that take place here. So we'll first start out, again, as mentioned, with a quick peek under the tent at the reporting capabilities, a very unique emphasis on reporting here on Platform that you just won't see in any other cultivation solution on the industry. I'll go ahead and pop open some of the usual suspect reports. We can kind of take a look at some of these in action. So the first set of reports we're looking at here would be an inventory report. An inventory report allows me to report upon any and all inventory that's currently in my facility, both medicated and non-medicated. It is worth noting that the MJ Freeway cultivation module is designed to manage both medicated and non-medicated inventory. So in the case of the grow, it could be things like nutrients. One of the biggest cost centers in the grow, where we can track nutrient ingredients as well as your medicated inventory. Looking here at this inventory dashboard, there's a couple different ways that we can look at data. The first and most foundational would be a tabular format. So those of you who are familiar or even perhaps Excel savvy, we can quickly and easily interact with this data in this tabular format. I can also quickly and easily pull data out and be able to manipulate it externally within an Excel format or similar. But the goal of the MJ Platform reporting engine really is to keep you out of Excel as much as possible. So things like basic sorting, filtering can quickly take place here in the appendices, in the tabular data, or even directly here in these visual representations. So for example, if I just wanted to see, say, flower inventory, I can click the slice of the pie, and you'll notice all these charts will filter down, showing me just this subset of inventory. So very, very unique emphasis on reporting. This is leveraging two industry-leading technologies, or really two leading technologies across any industry, using Oracle's Domo as well as the Snowflake. So between these two combinations, we're able to offer the industry the most robust reporting and business intelligence platform in the industry. It's also worth noting, too, these reports provide a macro or micro-level view, whereby I can report upon just one specific license in my ecosystem, or in this view here, see all my inventory across all of my facilities. Moving forward from inventory, the next stop on the tour would be this plants report. So this first section report is going to show me my current living plants at a glance. So in this case here, I've got a total of 2,281 plants, of which, let's say about a little over 1,000 plants here are jelly bean. And of that, I can see, well, how many of these plants are in the corresponding growth phases. In this case, 259 in veg, 388 in flowering, and then another 374 here in propagation. So basic data sorting, filtering, manipulations can, again, easily take place with just a couple clicks of the mouse. Another really compelling report here would be my plants forecasting report, where I can go ahead and look what's coming down in the future based upon previous planting dates. So in this case here, I can just drill down to some upcoming harvests and even look at one specific batch versus another. So in this case here, I can take one particular batch, see here was planted on actually January 1st of this year. We're going to be moving it, or have moved it into veg here as of 11:15. It looks like we're going to be moving it into the flowering phase in just a couple of days here on 2/5. Now, even more exciting is the fact that we expected to harvest here on 4/8, but we also know not only when we expect to harvest, but the anticipated harvest yield of both grams of flower, as well as grams of trim, in this case, 3,400 grams of flower, as well as another 600 grams of trim. So very, very unique forecasting capabilities built in the platform that again, you just won't see in other cultivation solutions. Again, all this data is also available in tabular format or can be interacted with throughout a number of the mechanisms here native in the reporting engine. Moving along, know that MJ Platform is a full supply chain solution, including AR and AP management. So in this case here, tracking my purchasing activities. And again, I can sort down and see just the purchasing activities related to my grow. This could be in the case of a cultivation, primarily say non-medicated ingredients such as nutrients. And we can go ahead and see this level of detail in this case. I purchased nearly $500,000 of inventory, but I've only made about a little less than 40K worth of payments against this. So I can see where I have outstanding monies due to my various vendors. I can also see, well, which vendors do I have monies due to as well. In addition to order or vendor level detail, we can even get down to line item level detail. And as we see here in my grow, one of the most frequently purchased products are my nutrients here, my rhizoenzyme A and B. You also see some of my more propagated materials, things like seeds, say if I bring in clones, any sort of material that I might be turning into plants, I can track the acquisition and the corresponding costs of these ingredients as well. Again, both medicated and non-medicated inventory management, all natively here within Platform. The counterpart to purchasing activities would be my wholesale activities. This section here for my sales order reports encompass all of my wholesale activities, so selling out products, which vendors am I selling to, what products are being sold, quantities of such, as well as corresponding costs. So much like before on the payment side, ensuring that my vendors are getting paid, well, in this case here, I'm making sure that I'm getting paid for those wholesale orders that I'm selling out to my various vendors. In the case of, say, California or other markets where there are wholesale supply chain taxes, know that we have the ability to maintain separate revenue streams for taxes as well as your product revenue and maintaining independence between those two separate revenue streams. We can look at sales orders at the order level detail, the line item level detail, really any combination of the sort, and again, in both tabular or dashboard style format as part of the reporting engine. Now, this is only just a selection of some of the usual suspect reports. Again, not limited to the reports shown here, a multitude of additional reports specifically built for the unique needs of the cannabis cultivator. Moving into the facility settings, again, a quick peek under the tent. We'll come back to these facility-specific location or settings here. I want to show you the advanced settings a bit first, though. Advanced settings are typically more administrative or global. These control things like users. So I can go ahead and ensure the individual users accessing the system have permissions to do so. So as you might expect, each individual accessing the system is going to have their own username and password, as well as corresponding roles at each and every license within their organization or ecosystem. In this case here, I don't have permissions for Maryland retail. I'll never know that I'm missing out on it. It's not present in the UI when I'm navigating between my licenses, nor will I ever have visibility into any of that facility's operations. Now, two, we can have different permissions based upon which license or facility we're talking about, where perhaps an employee is a manager at license A, but maybe a task laborer at location B, where we can differentiate and have unique permission sets for each license. And that ties to this roles management piece here, which is fully customizable. In addition to these prefabricated roles, you can create your own custom roles and name them however you see fit and customize the permissions within them. Somebody who is maybe a business owner would be a great example of an organization admin where they've got full permissions and they can do virtually everything under the sun as noted here. As you can tell, with just the sheer multitude of boxes here, very, very detailed, very exhaustive permission sets that allow you to control who has access to what information. Even being able to differentiate to who can look versus who can touch, i.e. who can view versus manage. So very, very granular, very detailed permission sets to safeguard the business, ensuring folks have access to what they need without having access to any information that's outside the scope of their role or above their pay grade. And this is a great example here. If we compare this to a grow laborer, only two boxes checked in the entire permission set here. Again, safeguarding your business and folks only have visibility into those features or functionalities in the software of which they have permissions. In certain markets where you're limited to a certain number of plants associated with a license, like Michigan or similar, we can track and limit how many plants you're allowed to have in the grow at any given point in time. We also have waste and destruction tracking, so we can go ahead and as waste is reported as part of your cultivation activities, a waste inventory package is created, and we can track the said destruction or removal of said waste packages. So full waste management. In addition to, we have a native QuickBooks export, as well as integration with a number of third-party accounting systems, anywhere from Sage Intacct, Oracle's NetSuite, and a variety of SAP products, as well as a number of others pending. So a variety of different accounting solutions available, depending upon your accounting needs. Taking a brief look at the facility settings, each location license in your ecosystem would be its own facility and have its own corresponding set of facility settings. In this case here, a great example would be my cultivation locations. Each one of my grow facilities is going to have a different layout. So I can customize my settings here using the same vernacular or verbiage that I use in my operation, giving me the visibility I'm looking for. In this case here, two sections times four zones means there's eight different planting areas. Could be eight rows, 8 by 8 lights. And I just know where within that indoor grow room, a given plant or plants is located. In this other example here, couple sections, couple locations. I just know roughly within a given greenhouse where a batch of plants might be located. So again, customizable to whatever level of granularity, visibility, or high level you're looking for. Same thing too with storage locations. This would just be where any finished product material or any material in progress would be stored. This could be like my dry cure rooms, storage vaults, storage rooms, anywhere I'm storing nutrients, finished products, really anything in between. Any parcel of inventory, medicated or non-medicated, is always going to be tied to a storage location. Also, two, full genetics management as part of cultivation management here in platform. So for example, my jelly bean example, we can go ahead and look at a specific level of detail about the strain, including my strain abbreviation or code, which is fully customizable. If we're doing any breeding programs, we can track back pollen donor and mother plants. MJ Platform is the only product that I've seen that has a parent-to-child association between strains and the corresponding phenos, so I can report upon a strain level, a pheno level, or any combination of the sort. In addition to genetics management, as mentioned before, also non-medicated ingredient tracking. So here's where I can go ahead and configure my ingredients and manage inventory quantities. In this case here, if I look at things like my nutrients, I can see my various corresponding nutrients, corresponding quantities, and also cost of nutrients. And these are managed in real time through a mechanism we refer to as feeding schedules that cost the, track the cost as well as the quantities of nutrients going into a given group of plants. A feeding schedule can be a one-time occurrence, or in this case here, a repeating occurrence where it's nourishing these plants at a given frequency, in this case, of every other day. Feeding schedules can be specific to given growth phases, specific rooms, to prevent misassociation of the feeding schedule to the wrong location or the wrong growth phase. Notice here that this is tracking also the fraction of a liter of nutrient that's going into each plant, as well as the corresponding cost. So managing the corresponding quantity based upon the number of plants associated with this given feeding schedule being run. So decrementing that quantity from inventory in real time and accumulating the cost of those nutrients, the cost of this batch during the production life cycle. Getting into day-to-day workflows, our first stop on the tour will be this plant section. This plant's listing is basically my cultivation at a glance. You might notice at the top here, it's subdivided into the three growth phases. So in this case here, I can see that I've got some 797 plants that are in propagation versus a different subset of plants or quantity that's in veg, in this case 539 versus however many plants that I have in flowering. This fourth tab, inactive, is for any plants that have ever been either destroyed or harvested. So it doesn't matter if a plant was in my cultivation for 300 days or 300 minutes. Anytime a plant is going to be in my location, I'm going to have a record of it. And I'm going to have a detailed record of each and every time that plant was touched, who touched it, and any changes associated with those. So in this case here, a plant was created. It was then modified into a new location. Some waste was reported, put into a new veg cycle, as well as a veg feeding schedule signed, and then finally destroyed here on that same day because, in this case here, aphid eggs were seen. So tracking of any notes associated with any actions, as well as any time an employee interacts with the plant, what changes were made, and when those changes took place. Creating plants is as quick and easy as selecting this Create Plants button and selecting from dropdowns. You'll notice in the case of MJ Platform, very, very little data entry. So I can go ahead and designate my strain. And you'll also notice here too, no freeform data entry. Jack Herrera's of common strain is also commonly misspelled. So no more do we have to worry about dirty data. We're standardizing things by selecting from really a drop down here. I can go ahead and add a phenotype where appropriate, add my planting date, and we now have a batch name, which is just a combination of the strain or pheno abbreviation and the planting date. So if I look at a given batch or plant ID, I know not only what strain or pheno is that, but also the age of the plant, because the planting date is quickly and easily available there. In the case of managing inventory where I've got seeds or clones, I can quickly and easily convert these inventory units into living plants. Or maybe I'm cloning from an existing mother plant. Well, MJ Platform has the ability to provide you visibility into genealogy. In this case here, my mother plant, as well as a matriarch plant where applicable as well too, ensuring that I'm making the most strategic and the best cloning options based upon my most vigorous mother plants. So from here, hit save and return, and we'll notice that in about four clicks and or maybe five clicks and a couple keystrokes, we've now created a batch of 20 clones. To find that batch of clones, I can quickly and easily either scan in or type in that batch ID. Note MJ Platform does include a full labeling engine, which allows me to quickly and easily label plants with any number of detail. This is fully customizable and allows me to print out something as basic and standard as maybe a 2x1 adhesive label, or get a little bit more fancy and allow me to print out on wrap tags and have one tag that follows that plant throughout its entire life cycle. From here, then I can just scan in or type in that plant ID or batch ID and bring back that entire group of plants. From here, mass actions. At no point do I want to interact with an individual plant. I can go ahead and grab a single batch or multiple batches at the same time and move multiple groups of plants in mass actions. I can do that here by selecting that group of plants, hitting plant modification, and proceeding from there. Well, notice right now, being in the veg phase, we do not have a feeding schedule, or excuse me, the prop phase, we don't have the veg feeding schedule available. It's not until I move this into the veg phase that I now have that veg feeding schedule as an option. Perhaps I'm changing locations, maybe not. Add the modification date. If there's any additional detail I want to capture, I can always capture here in the notes field. Otherwise, I'll go ahead and hit modify group. And then now 3-4 clicks, we've modified all 20 plants from one location to another or one phase to another and assigned a new feeding schedule to that group. So if I move to the vegetative tab here, we'll see all 20 plants are now in the vegetative phase. And again, I can quickly and easily grab this group of plants, modify them, say now into the flowering phase. Well, notice that now when we're in flowering, I cannot misassociate the veg feeding schedule to the flowering phase. Again, phase-specific logic based upon those feeding schedules. So from here, 2 clicks, and we've now modified this group into a new phase. So again, nobody is home in the vegetative phase for this batch. They've all been moved to the flowering phase. So when I come to this flowering phase tab here, I can find all 20 plants. You'll see that there is a new option. Note that if at any point you are wholesaling your genetics out, I can quickly and easily convert living plants into inventory units and go ahead and sell them out wholesale. So if that's ever part of my operation, I can convert plants, say, to clones and sell out immature plants. But in this case here, since we're now in the flowering phase, what's probably more likely is I'm going to go ahead and harvest all 20 plants. Now, in some states, you can go ahead and you can take the overall wet weight of the entire batch and use that accordingly. In other states, we're going to need to weigh each plant individually. Now, the platform has a setting that allows you to force the use of individual plant values where applicable based upon your given jurisdiction or regulations. So from here, once each of these plants are weighed, we can go ahead and indicate where this batch is going to be stored. I'll put it in my DTC or my dry churn cure room, add any notes where applicable, and now I can go ahead and print out a harvest batch label. I can print out multiple harvest batch labels. This will just allow me to keep this batch of plants separate from any other plants in my drying room. So from this point, we'll notice if we look back in the plant section, this group of 20 plants has now been moved to the inactive tab. So if I search for this batch name here in inactive, we'll see all 20 plants that we've just harvested together are now visible here. So what would happen at this point is we'd now move from the plant section to the harvest section. Again, this plants listing is all my cultivation activities or all my plants that are currently active in my grow at any point in time. This harvest batch section is a listing of all the material that's been harvested, but not yet broken down into finished product and material. So go ahead and find today's batch here. There this is. And what's typically going to happen is this harvest batch is going to dry over time. And this 30,000 grams is going to turn into more like, say, 6,000 grams, accounting for about an 80% moisture loss. So we'll see once we lock in this new harvest weight, when we return to the harvest batch listing screen, it's going to go ahead and capture the expected or the total accumulated moisture loss at this point in time, in this case, 80%. So now that we have this dried harvest batch, I can go ahead and create product lots from this material. So from here, I go ahead and indicate what product we're creating, the corresponding product weight, and also the gross weight. In this case here, let's assume that I put this 4,500 grams of material into a 1,500 gram container, giving me a 6,000 gram gross weight. This means that in order to verify how much inventory is in that container, I don't have to worry about opening the container and risk spilling any inventory or it no longer being sellable. I can verify that total gross weight, confirming the contents are indeed in place. So from here, I'll go ahead and add a storage location. I'll put it back in my vault, and we're just about off to the races. I'll go ahead and I'll add a second lot here too. Go ahead and create some jelly bean trim, say to the tune of 800 grams. And maybe again, putting that in a 1,500 gram container, giving me 2,300 gram gross weight. You'll notice that I can't create these packages unless I go ahead and add a storage location. So I'll do just that. We'll put this back in the vault as well. So boom, I'll go ahead and create lots. And this is going to create two different product lots for me. So now if we look at my inventory section, you'll see that there are two new packages that have been created today. Here a batch to the tune of 4,500 grams of buds that was just created, as well as the corresponding 800 grams of trim. From here, I can quickly and easily move inventory out to one of my vendors to the supply chain. Again, any incoming inventory is tracked to a purchase order and the corresponding inventory receipt. One thing worth noting is we do have inventory to vendor-specific logic. So if I select this given vendor here, I'm only going to see that subset of products I purchased from that vendor, as opposed to selecting another vendor, which creates an entirely different list of products. So very, very unique logic as far as the inventory management and purchasing action. Same thing too among the sales orders. So creating a wholesale order is as easy as specifying who are we selling to, any number of my vendors, which one of their facilities, if they have multiple facilities, and then which products are being sold out. In this case here, I'll go ahead and add my buds to this order. And we'll sell, let's say, all 4,500 grams of bud that we just created here together. Say maybe $1.50 per gram. Let me quickly and easily add additional products to the order here. I'll just do one for time's sake, where they're going to indicate the order status. So order placed, partial payment paid in full, transfer type, be it internal or wholesale. In this case, I'm doing an internal transfer. Then any sort of transfer fees or taxes, in addition to the product revenue, will give us our invoice total. This gray box down here is banking payments against this invoice. Maybe it's multiple incremental payments or one single payment. I don't really care. I just want to track as payments are being received and as this balance reaches $0. And we also have integrated logic too, where if I'm moving inventory from one of my facilities to another, I click this little handy dandy box, and hitting save here not only creates the sales order in the producing or selling facility, but also creates a corresponding purchase order in the acquiring facility. Once the order has been created, we can quickly and easily fulfill this order by grabbing said order and hit the fulfill sales order button. At this point, this will initiate a transfer. So I can add additional detail to the order, including things like driver and vehicle, methods of transport, directions where appropriate. Otherwise, the most important detail is going to be the batch specification. There is a first-in, first-out inventory logic here. So by selecting the highest numerical value, I'm getting my most recently created batch. You can see here, here's our batch from 2-2, with all 4,500 grams. From there, all I need to do is add the date fulfilled and the transfer status. So this is open or on hold versus out for delivery or completed. So I'll go ahead and say this is open, thereby putting this inventory on reserve for the specific order. Once the transfer is initiated, I've got two different documents that I can print out, a manifest and an invoice. Based upon your local regulations, this manifest may or may not be usable. In the case that you have to use a state-issued manifest, like say a metric state, our manifest can still be useful as a pick list, where it's got all of the applicable information as myself as the producer, the purchaser's details, the driver and vehicle that has been selected for this order, as well as the corresponding product being used for the fulfillment, including batch and or package ID. Again, pick list, making it really quick and easy to grab this order. The second document that this creates is an invoice, as well here in a PDF format, meaning I can go ahead and quickly and easily attach this to an email, and my vendors have now received their invoice. I'm going to get the MJ Freeway logo here, but your own logo and branding can be uploaded here to make this a professionally branded invoice with little or no effort.